so tell me about yourself. What makes you happy?
Life. you think about just the fact that we're alive and we've got this opportunity to just be and learn, and there's lots of reasons that we can get frustrated, and you know, there's hiccups and hang-ups and bang-ups, but at the end of the day we're kind of on reasonably borrowed time, and probably the experiences that I've had in my life have kind of said to me that yeah, there's beauty in everything, even the tougher times, or even, you know, the little things. I mean, you know, that flower is beautiful, and these vegetables, and yeah, so I suppose I do love life, and I love people, and I love travel. Travel in terms of space and place and country, but then also travel in the mind and in the thoughts and in the ideas and the thinking and the vision. See, I suppose it's a bit like this. Oh yeah, actually, it's a bit like the stool here. I like the stool. But yeah, it's got three legs, and if I had to sort of mark down the three legs, I'd say it would be people. And I suppose under that you've got family and friends, and then there's travel. And then there's environment. So between those three things, that's who I am, really. The travel was instilled in me when I was young, I suppose, because I got a Greek background, and so I always wanted to learn about that and that side of me and what made my blood move the way it did, and that history. The environment was something that I've always loved to learn from, and my grandfather was a market gardener, and he kind of connected me to the earth pretty young, because I used to sit in his garden and work with him and do stuff and things. And then the people side, I suppose, because of the Greek and being taught Greek language from a young age, even though it was difficult and, you know, it didn't really fit in, you know, going to Greek school. But I realised at age 14 when I went to Greece that was probably the biggest gift my parents ever gave me. And that ability to communicate to people, but in another language, and then to be able to appreciate what their environment had done to their ability to communicate and understand the world. And I suddenly appreciated that I had this opportunity to have two views. And then I learned French at school as well, so that gave me another view. And then when I lived in Europe, I learned German, Austrian German. You know, the Germans would say, yeah, that's an Austrian dialect. But yes, I learned how to speak Wiener Deutsch. You know, das ist eine Wahnsinn. So I learned that. And then I also learned how to speak Czech as well, roughly, but, you know, because I spent a lot of time there. But the bottom line is that people are the same. You know, people generally want the same things. You know, they just want a simplicity. They want to be able to, you know, eat well and have their family and dote over grandchildren and love their kids and, you know, have structure and form in their lives. But it's just affected then environmentally. You know, in Austria they got high-pitched roofs because they got snow and it's cold in the winter. We snow for us in Australia was always a holiday. Whereas living in Vienna, you got everyone on the peak hour going to work in the snow. And so you know, our environment shapes our culture, or builds our habits, and our habits build culture, and our culture is who we then kind of express ourselves as. So, you know, I'm very appreciative of my background. But equally, in terms of that stool and people and place, I've been learning a lot more about, you know, our indigenous heritage over the last 5 to 7 years, and traveling a lot and going out on a lot of country, and had the privilege of being welcomed on country, and you know, that's affecting who I am. It's made me realize new things about life and the world, It's nice to sort of experience new chapters and where those chapters will take me. So yeah, I love life. I love plants, I love growing things. I love swimming, I love body surfing and surfing. Yeah, I do lots of things, but it's like everything has its place. Some people are into other things. You know, some people go, oh, I can't grow stuff. I go, no, yes, you can. And so, yeah, life's a pretty special thing.
Costa, now tell me about your projects and their mission.
I suppose my projects and my mission as a whole, if you had to look down on it and say, well, where does it fit? I think it fits under the broad banner of environmental education and awareness, but that environment is the question. Like the environment from an aperture point of view, I'm talking big picture environment, like the planet, Mother Earth, how we treat it, how we treat her, what we do, but then also the environment in terms of the environment where we live specifically, and then the environment very specifically around us as our own personal environment. So if I talk about, you know, growing food, that's all about nutrition for your personal environment, to understand that. But then when you grow your own food and you advocate freshness and local and seasonal, you're then a model. You're a role model for the people around you. So, do I want to change the world? That's a big task. And to take that on, I think, is a bit it's not unrealistic, it's a big burden. And I don't think you want to burn out on those things. So I like to say, well, just change the world that is your world. And then you become that model, and you affect people around you, because when they come and see you growing, or they see you excited about something, then they can become excited, or you can give your produce away, or you can share a recipe for less toxic body care products. So on that same picture about what I'm about, it's really pointless if I say to you, grow the best organic produce in the world, and this is how you do it with rock minerals, and you know, you can even go into preparations and biological fertilizers and all of that holistic approach. But if you're putting aluminium under your armpits, you're washing yourself with industrial floor cleaner on your body scrubs and your shampoos and your things, well, as Sean Penn said in his movie The Human Experiment, if you're exposed to 100 chemicals before you walk out the door at 7:30 in the morning, I think me having you eat organic produce is, it's kind of like just blowing in the breeze, because you're poisoning yourself. And so my approach is to say, well, let's look at the big picture, but let's finesse and pan that big picture down to exactly how you can make really simple changes like that, but not intimidating, not as you must or you have to. It's just, here's the options. And if you look at that or you look at that, it's kind of self-explanatory. In that sense, from an environmental education point of view, or a personal education point of view, or just a health education point of view, it's really about saying, hey, just take one thing at a time. Do it at your pace, whether it's your antiperspirant, and take the anti out and just go for a deodorant, whether it's the type of hair care products you use, whether it's the face creams. Every little action you take creates a new shape and a new direction and a new future. And I don't underestimate the smallest of actions, because they build momentum.
And how is it to be involved in these projects, and how do you feel about the work you do with them?
I suppose I don't underestimate the power of the smallest things. If anything, the more I do this, the more I value the little things and the little projects and the little initiatives that people are doing, because they're the ones that are on the ground and that people assimilate almost without realizing. You can make big winds of change, but it's also the little breezes that I see everywhere. And, you know, in my role, working on in the media, there's a certain, I wouldn't say expectation, but there's a certain understanding that if you come there, people think, oh, that's important. If I come to a small region or a small village and say, oh, I love what you're doing, it's almost like there's this expectation that an outsider's endorsement is better than a local. And I get great pleasure out of saying to people, hey, what you're doing here is nuts. It's awesome. It's nationally significant. It's not, oh, this little village outside of Melbourne or this tiny little town 500 kilometers north of Sydney to the west somewhere. It's like, no, that little project, your people here are as valuable as anyone that you read in the media, anyone that you see in books, anyone that you see anywhere, because they're doing it in these conditions right here. I'm no garden guru to come to your town or to their town and say, yeah, I understand it. I bring sort of principles, but more so motivation. And, you know, I could bring, you know, a little bag like this. And this is called boomerang bags. Borrow and bring back. And like, this is a couple of people's idea to saying, hey, we want to stop plastic bags on the land ending up in creeks and rivers and then the ocean. And so they said, all right, let's get hold of old fabric. These are old tea towels, they're old tablecloths and things. And they've sewn them together into a bag and say, well, I don't need a plastic bag. And so I carry things in that. And I'll get multiple use. So this whole idea of single use, this built-in obsolescence that we make something and throw it away, you can make a change. And then you take that to your village and say, well, let's ban plastic bags. And then that village starts, and you take it to the council and you say, well, let's ban them in the region. And then from the region becomes the state, and the state becomes the nation. So you know, that little bag is as important as any grand policy announcement, as any grand media-driven, big dollar-driven initiative to ban something or change something. It starts at the grassroots level, and that's what I love, getting out there and saying to people, that's on the pulse. That's like, poof, and I love it.
That's beautiful, Costa. What is the change you want to make in the world?
To help people realize that they matter and that they can make a difference, and that one person or a small group of people, I think it was Margaret Mead that said it was only ever, real change was only ever made by small groups of people. So I suppose I want to use my current position in terms of the media, but just generally anyway, to be able to inject enthusiasm, and particularly when people are waning, because, you know, a lot of projects are always going to, when you're driving change, if you're in the change making world, you're up against it, and it's very easy to feel a burden, to feel that weight, because you're constantly pushing against the river, you're pushing against the flow. And I suppose I like to sort of say to people, well, you know, get caught up in those side eddies on the side of the river and allow it to maybe go back a little and then come up and go up, rather than go right out into the middle of the river and try and stop it. So when people do feel that burnout or that fatigue, it generally doesn't take much to bring them back up again. And sometimes that's just a basic recognition, a little award, like just an afternoon tea and a piece of cake. Like, that's sometimes enough. Just And then that person will come and tend this garden for the next 6 months because they've been recognized. A little article in the paper, a thank you, a note, a card, a public statement by the local mayor or the minister or whatever, but making those efforts to say, hey, yes, in change making you're up against it. It is an attrition thing, because and a lot of the times, because people feel isolated, they feel that burden more. And what I like to do is interconnect these things and say, well, you know that in Port Macquarie they're doing this, and in Woodend there's a farmer doing that, and that guy's doing it because these guys up in Atherton Tablelands are doing this microbiological fertilizer that's been done by Mushumas in Latin America, and these guys are doing wonderful things. But you know, the mainstream is sort of looking at it and saying, oh, that's all a bit sort of not scientific enough for us. But you just say, this feels right, this is what we're doing, these guys are doing it, they're having success, come and visit their farm, ring this person, email that person. You know, they started a seed library in Port Macquarie Library, and then I go and plant the seeds for them to do it in Lismore, Mwillimbah and Ballina. And so suddenly there's now going to be three seed libraries. And then other people are following suit. So basically saying to people, hey, you're not alone. And take not solace. Don't go, oh, well, I'll just, yeah, at least there's someone. No, take great drive from the fact that you can share your project and let someone else's eyes come over it, and they might add to yours, and you might take their book project and do something like this. So yeah, I suppose in terms of the, you know, if there was a villain, if there was a difficulty, it's just knowing that you can be your own worst enemy, and don't do that, because you've got enough forces against you. So use every opportunity to recognize, celebrate, congratulate, and propagate the thinking. The other thing in all of this change making is there's one ingredient that people are pretty quick to misinterpret, and that's patience. Because it's important to be excited. It's important to agitate and fire up and have drive. But when you come across the first speed hump, impatience will derail projects. And I think patience is a very good virtue, because it helps you to really digest and ingest what it is that you're doing. And you know, when you come up against a council protocol, it's very easy to go, oh, council, oh, it's taken 18 months for them to approve our space here for a community garden, and you know, woe, grief, anger, discontent, harsh words, guilt, all together, wrap it up into this really bitter pill. Instead of going, no, we're doing something of merit, and things of merit have to get built on a solid foundation. And if we just whip it up really quickly, it's just gonna blow over just as quickly as we built it. So when I go to communities and they say, oh, we've spent 18 months and we're just opening the community garden now, I don't go, oh, what a pain, you know, oh, bloody councils all around the country, they're this and they're that. I go, that's fantastic, 18 months is nothing. Because this is gonna go for 18 years or 180 years, or it's gonna have a change and a legacy. It's gonna have a legacy. You know, it's gonna even remember 18 months, but you do remember it when you tell others and say, yeah, you got this problem, but don't worry, because we got through it. And it brought the community stronger. Otherwise, if we just dish it out, it's like going to a free gig. If you know it's free, you go, oh, well, I see you there, yeah, yeah, and then on the day, oh, it's a bit overcast, I won't go. And you got a ticket, you go, oh, it's raining, but I don't care, I want to see that gig. And it's the same. There's a very fine line between what people generally say is like impatience and the merit of patience. And And time is required for good things. So I like to really recognize that with communities and groups and projects and say, wow, you know, you've done this in this little time. You know, the other day I was down at the Sustainable Living Week in Albury, Wodonga. And the mixture of events that were on were fantastic, from a preschool writing, the kids illustrating a book and authoring it. And this is preschool, called Wiggly Worms. And we presented that at the library. I did a reading of it. And these kids were the authors. And I said, oh, I've never been in a room with so many authors and illustrators. And you know, the kids were like so chuffed, and they're selling that as a fundraiser, and then they'll do it again. And that's as, that, and the message in that was about the importance of worms. And we had the worm farm there, the kids were holding the worms. They weren't going, yeah, yuck, 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 yuck. So, you know, there's that stepping stone into understanding soil and humus and compost and the importance of microbes and bugs and worms and bacteria and all those things. And we started off in the kids there. Then, you know, the next project that we went to was a project where the council were working with handicapped and disabled people or disadvantaged people to build garden beds on the streets to grow food. So that's another thread that ties in. And there was another group that's growing the local seed, which they're going to put out into the local reserves and things to build local biodiversity and habitat to bring the birds back, which will control the insects that will eat the plants. And they've identified 51 native bush tucker plants, which they're going to grow seed plants from and then put those out throughout the community to explain and educate about bush tucker. So there's just three things. You know, and in the space of 2 days, I then went to a garden club where the garden club had a directory of all the the council garden awards, and they set up a booklet marking all the gardens, all the public spaces with gardens, who to contact, who to communicate with. Like, that they're valuable tools that any community can copy. So for me, it's like you need the patience to allow the project to realize and blossom, and then other people will see the flower and come and take that flower and adapt it and adjust it. So for me, whether it's the kids writing a book, a local group going around and collecting fruit from people, what were they called? They were called the fruit hunters or something, and they go around and collect the fruit and box it and give it out to people rather than it fall on the ground. So all of these levels, whether it's at the vegetable level, whether it's at a policy level, whether it's at a book writing level from kids to council writing a sustainability guide, equally, they're all equally as important in my eyes. I will get excited about, you know, this bag project as I will about the kids book project, as I will about the local seed saving or the free seed library. To me, they're just all one big part of the picture.
So how did you decide that this change is the one you need to make?
It sort of became clearer to me when I saw what was going on and the fact that it wasn't being heard about, it wasn't being recognised, and it even wasn't being engaged with. Wasn't being taught. You know, anyone can tell a story, but we need to get those stories connected. So I was seeing all these things around, and it just inspired me even more to say, well, I want to make these connections. I want to show people how it's the storytelling that's the most important part, because no one will know anything about what you do if you can't tell them. So in my opportunity when it came up with media, it's like, okay, this is what I love. How can I look at it already and I love it and I see it and I can see the threads, but what I have to do is tie those threads together and then throw it out as a blanket over everyone and say, well, this is all of our business. And it's got to have energy, it's got to have excitement, but it's also got to have information that people can replicate and absorb. So it kind of just kind of just happened like that. It was all the things that I love. And it wasn't like I said, oh, on one particular day, I want to go out and educate the world. It was sort of like, oh, well, I'm just learning all this stuff. It just became a flow. It was like, well, it's coming in here, it's got to go out. It was as this give and take thing. And yeah, I mean, now, you know, I mean, people like to put you into a container and say, oh, you know, are you a landscape architect? Are you a television host? Are you a presenter? Are you a environmental educator? Are you a health educator? Are you whatever? I like to look at it and say, well, it's like an old switchboard that used to have the wires all coming in, you know, just plug them all in and then they can go out through a big broadband cable out that way. And each one of these cables is as valuable as the other, because everyone will be attracted to a different thing. Someone might get off on growing the veggies. Someone else is going to get into how the bees work and getting into the bees. Someone else is into how can I control those bugs by planting, you know, some low spiky native shrubs that allow the birds to come and feed on those bugs. Someone else is interested in the water and catching the water or reflecting the energy and storing the energy and using solar panels. Someone else is involved and fired up and excited about the food system and what can we do with it? Let's have a grower's market. And then someone else says, oh yeah, well, let's have a grower's market, but let's have the grower's market on a Wednesday in the middle of the week as well. So we're not saying to the big forces of the food system, we're going to stop you. We're saying, no, we're just going to provide an option. And then someone says, yeah, all right, well, we'll do it on the Wednesday and we'll do it on the weekend, but then we're also going to have a box system. And then I'm going to have maybe an outlet here. And so the ways that people can engage, whether it's from food sovereignty and food security, whether it's to food nutrition and soil health or bugs and entomology or cooking, and nutrition and recipes, and saying, you know, you can have all these vegetables that you might never touch in your life, but if you put them in a green smoothie and it's got a nice flavor, you suddenly eat them and you reckon you can't even cook. But yeah, okay, have your green smoothie every day. We know then you've got a nutritional level that has at least got at least 2 to 3 of your 4 or 5 serves of veg in at the beginning of the day. So someone else is into fabric. Someone else is into messages, you know, like I love the message side of things, you know, that you can just pull out a t-shirt and say, well, you know, if you wear that, you're making a statement. And it's not an in-your-face statement. People are going to see you. You're going to be walking on the street. You're going to be on the bus. People will think twice. They'll go, oh, you know, this is one of my favorites. I love this one. Chickens, they know everything. And you know, today, before sitting down here, I just went over the road to the little cafe there. And whenever I'm here at the office, I go over to the local cafe. They do a whole lot of juicing and I end up with about 15 kilos worth of juice pulp, which I give to my chickens and I give to my worms. So there's so many ways, and I suppose it's a bit pyromanical. I like to just ignite whatever bit that is, you know. It could be just that you like to eat that flour in your salad. Actually, I shouldn't let that go to waste. But it's like, well, if you just get involved with those flowers and then you learn more about the flowers, then you're going to get more into horticulture and growing, and then you're going to grow different things and understand the seasons and then understand seed saving. And if you understand seed saving, that will take you to another level. You'll mix with different people. Who knows, you might meet your partner at the seed saving club or at the food festival. So it's life. It's just about giving people all these ways to engage.
What kind of rewards do you get from working as a change maker?
The rewards are amazing. I mean, you know, just yesterday we were working at a school up in the Northern Rivers at UKI, and Actually, it wasn't Ukiah, it was Balamble, and one of the young girls, year five girl, we just planted some citrus trees, and she said at the end, one day my children will eat from these trees. And you know, that when you can, whatever amount it was, but when you can have a little part in that kind of light bulb moment, well, that for me is what makes it worthwhile. I'm not doing it for that. Like, I'm not looking for those things, because the best part about those ones is they come up unexpected, and it's the unexpected nature of them that's the best. Because I've had one where you know, I did something, a discussion at a nursery industry event, and then a particular individual left the nursery and then got involved with a local club and has now turned around the club and has got a huge veggie patch and 20 or 30 chickens, which provides the food for the club, sort of thing. And then someone else bumped into me recently. Well, I'm involved with this organisation called Centre for Sustainability Leadership, and I was at a youth food movement. So again, different groups shedding light on different angles, but the youth food movement doing wonderful things for young people to get involved with food and the picture of food. And I was at this one, and I met a girl who was studying at Sydney Uni, and we were chatting, and one thing led to another, and I said, oh, you should have a look at this Centre for Sustainability Leadership courses. And that was it. That was just didn't hear anything about it ever since. And then last week I went to the graduation ceremony, because I'm a mentor for those courses. Anyway, this girl came up to me and she said, and it was funny, because the youth food movement function was at the Rocks at Pier 3, and we were at Pier 4 for this graduation. She came up to me and she said, do you realize that's where you told me, or you mentioned this, and then I'm now here graduating? And you know, that's tears, you know, that brings you to tears. It was a beautiful moment, because if she hadn't told me, it wouldn't have changed what happened, which is beautiful. The fact that she told me is like, I mean, where does my energy come from? Well, that's a big source of it, when you know that people come back and tell you something like that, and you go, well, all I did was just pass something on, just be a little medium between one and the next. So you don't do it for that. But at the same time, when you're doing what you love, you're kind of a model, and people are watching. And you know, particularly in the media, I mean, you know, in this public position, people are watching all the time. You know, I can't eat, I can't drink out of plastic bottles if I'm making a public statement saying, I want to ban single-use plastic. So you can't just go, oh, well, I'll just do it. Just this once, it'll be fine. And I think that's really good. And I mean, that sort of became instilled in me through doing things with my local school, because when you're at the school, you can't swear. You can't jaywalk in front of the school. You can't throw rubbish on the ground. You're under observation the whole time. And the same through refereeing rugby that I've done for years and years and years. When I'm in the street, people see me and know me as a rugby referee, and they remember and recognise that position from the field, but they recognise it in the street. And so you're a model. And I think the more we conveniently recognise that we are what we say we are, then that responsibility translates into a daily educational mechanism without even trying. Because if I'm not holding a plastic throwaway cup, or I'm holding a glass, and then people go, oh, where'd you get that? I go, oh no, I bring it with me. Then that can be a light bulb moment for that person. So to me, it comes back that way. You know, whatever, when I see people excited about a project, that fuels me. And then I can take it and share it and say, hey, and then excite those people, and then they excite someone else, and they excite someone else, and you know, someone's probably looking down from up there wondering what's going on there, and they go, oh, let's go down and have a look at that garden one day. And then they meet the gardener and they say, oh, why don't you come and join this community garden? So it's all about not underestimating where and what it is that can fuel you. doesn't have to be big, big recognitions. It's just little things, little moments, and you go, ah.
Oh. It's because of this that you do what you do and you keep doing it. Is this what inspires you, or is there other things?
I suppose what inspires me is the fact that there is a lot of change building. You know, the little drafts have become breezes, and the breezes are becoming winds, and the winds are becoming sort of stronger. And if you could look at anything and go, oh, that's, you know, oh, that's just one market here, or that's just one little bag. But what the beauty of today is that you've got all these groups. So whether you're talking about Tim and Take Three, or whether you're talking about Silka and Paul and Two Hands Project, or like for the ocean, like the ocean and the land, you know, what we do on the land ends up in the ocean. So it's only natural that these links are made. And as we make these links, then it builds this chain, so that then people say, no, we don't want to destroy our aquifers and destroy our water storage and destroy our agricultural lands for the sake of a short-term gain. And people are now realizing, slowly but surely, but they may get that by going to the beach and seeing Tim's group there, or they may get that by watching, you know, Gardening Australia, or they may get it by seeing someone holding a glass and having their coffee in a glass. But whatever it is, it's all adding to a movement. And that's what motivates me more, because, you know, having gone to the Tarkine rainforest and stood amongst hundreds and thousands, just thousands of year old ecosystem, and you just realize we are so tiny, and we've done so much damage, yet there's so much beauty. And to be able to absorb that beauty and bring it back and use that to inspire people to create that little bit of beauty, then we can undo, we can start to repair and regenerate the damages that have been done to the ecosystem and to our planet. And I think it's achievable, but we just have to start. And if it's only one square meter, I'm happy, because that's one square meter that less. Then that inspires the person over the road to do it, and that's 10 square meters less, and then 100 square meters, and then 1,000.
Costa, how successful do you believe you've been as a change maker?
Look, schools and school gardens and community gardens and things like that, if my input in it has helped to bring awareness and bring that vocabulary onto people's lips and have them talking about schools and school gardens, and have them taking it to the next level, where the school garden is providing for the tuck shop, and they're then hooking up with the wonderful people doing nutrition programs and things like that. So I suppose, am I being successful there? Yes, I am, because I'm driving it and I'm visiting as many schools as I can and supporting the programs that are out there, and also supporting new programs that are popping up as well. So that's a big one. Equally with the community gardens, that people shouldn't be afraid to have a go. You know, that's probably the biggest thing I like to say, is just have a crack. You don't have to be a gardener. You don't have to be a horticulturalist. You don't have to be a landscaper or a landscape architect or a botanist or whatever. Just get the basic information and go out and do it and start observing. And if you start doing that, it's actually going to change your life. So in that sense, it's, you know, my change making is more about giving people an excuse to back themselves, and that don't be critical and don't feel like you're under scrutiny, because if it stuffs up, who cares? Have another go. You've just learned something. Why did it stuff up? You didn't water it. That's simple. Or you watered it too much. But then when you get that first harvest, you're never going to look back. And, you know, I like to say to people, just start small. Start with just a little area and then away you go. Or start by reducing your plastic bag use. Or start by changing your toothpaste and getting a chemical out of your life. Just start. Just, and And yeah, if you know, me doing my street garden has inspired people to do street gardens, or to call me when they have a problem with their council so I can write a letter of support, well, you know, I'd say then that I'd value those as my trophies of success. Because if people feel comfortable to connect and say, hey, help me, then that's a victory.
And what would you consider your greatest achievement so far, and what do you think still remains to be done?
I'd hope that, you know, my greatest achievement so far was just breaking down barriers, just giving people a freedom not to feel intimidated, not to feel like this is all to be done by others, and to inspire people to realize that their observations matter, because it's their observations in their place that are critical to where they are in the world, and that if they do that, they're going to be a real change maker. So that I'd consider that opportunity to be able to, you know, any opportunity to speak in front of kids is a privilege that I don't take for granted in the slightest, because that's a real community privilege to do that. And I understand that those eyes and those impressionable eyes are listening. And, you know, it has to be inspiring to be able to let them know that the world is a wonderful place, and it's the opportunities are there, and that's not being unrealistic, but they've got plenty of time to have cynics weather that down. And I think the longer we can inject them with awe and wonder, then the better that is. And I think it's equally with people. It's amazing when you just inject a little bit of awe and wonder in people over the fact that they had success growing something, or their worm farm's working, or they're now buying local food and they're feeling better. The seasonal produce, they're eliminating all the products and all the preservatives and all of these things. So I suppose the other area that I'm most proud of is just getting people aware of their food and where it comes from, and igniting and elevating farmers to the top position where they should be, because we are nothing without food, and our farmers and growers and producers are the ones. So yeah, I'd value that pretty high, that every day I'm constantly making the point that we've got to connect, support, recognize and celebrate our farmers more, and put them at the top. And then become one, you know, become a little backyard, balcony, rooftop, veranda, courtyard grower. And then you can understand what they go through. And if you understand what they grow through, then you'll grow through it as well. And then you'll appreciate your food, and there'll be less waste, because you'll buy and cook differently, and you'll understand seasons. And then by understanding seasons, you'll stretch seasonality and preserve when there's an abundance, and pickle and ferment and do all these things with food, and dry them and whatever, so that the season extends. But then when the season's over, it's over, and you move to the next thing. So yeah, the whole food message, I think, is probably one area that I'm most happy with, because it's something that I don't have to think about very much.
If you were in a position of power, Costa, like a major or a minister, what policies would you put in place?
I suppose if I was the leader of the world, the first ministry I'd set up would be the Ministry of Humus, and it would be the top ministry. And underneath that, there would be a minister for compost, a minister for soil nutrition, soil health, and carbon levels. There'd be a nutritional a minister for health and nutritional. There'd be a minister for food and food distribution and markets. There'd be a minister for local produce, and they would all be answerable, and every ministry would be answerable to the Ministry of Humus, because it's either building humus or detracting from it, and they would have to answer for that. So yeah, that would be where I'd start. And under that, of course, you'd have water, you'd have biodiversity. That they would be the key ministries: humus, water, biodiversity, food. and then everything else would answer to those. And I reckon if we did something like that, our priorities would change very quickly. And, you know, the Minister for Seasonality would be there at customs and say, sorry, they're out of season, they can't come in. You know, can you imagine? I mean, that's just a G-up, but it'd be a lot. But it's not a joke, it's actually for real. That's what I'd do. And it would change the world, because then the priorities would be on local, and then getting local right so that everyone's eating local. That local would build a regional identity, and then from the regional identity would become national significance, because this region is known for this is that, but our local people are all eating well, we're putting the money back into local, it builds regional, it then builds national, and then international can come from there. So it would be a turnaround on the kind of belief that we'll all be great if we have all these exports, but just pillage what we've got. And you know, I was in the Northern Rivers, and lots of their food goes out. In the Riverina, most of their food is exported. The locals don't even see any of their food. That's craziness. So yeah, Ministry of Humus, key ministries under that: water, food, and biodiversity. And then under that come all the others.
I think we're getting a storm.
Yeah, that's good.
We can finish
that. Yeah, the planet is in agreement. The planet is in agreement.
Yeah.
It's going, yeah.
Costa, how has your work towards change impacted your life? So what impact has it had in your relationships with people around you?
I suppose it's a bit of a double-edged sword, because of the fact that I travel a lot. It sometimes means that I don't get as much time at home as I always would like. But then at the same time, I look at that and I go, well, okay, that's part of what I'm doing. And if I want to do this in the vehicle that I'm in, which is a national program with a national profile, well, that's part of my role, and it's part of my obligation and responsibility. It's not a privilege and a right. Like, it's really something that I'm committed to. So yeah, I don't get to spend as much time with all of my friends as I used to, but they're pretty understanding, and I'd say that's one trade-off. Outside of that, I've got relationships with people all around the country now. So everywhere I go, every region I go to, I'm meeting people. Building connections with people that will be there forever. And at every opportunity I have, I talk about what they're doing, I promote what they're doing in social media platforms, and just say, hey, you know, in this region, these people are doing great stuff, try this, do that. And that's a big part of what I'm obliged to do, because if I get a chance to see these things, it's important that I talk about it and share the stories. Because ultimately it's about all these little stories changing the big picture, and each and every one of them is valid.
A barrier for people wanting to become full-time change makers lies on the difficulty of financially supporting themselves and their projects. How did you overcome this barrier?
Don't underestimate the little details, because the little details are what makes the story either sink or swim. And don't underestimate who it is that you may come across at different times, because you just never know what the person on the train, the person that just asked you this question, that little email or that question from you know, someone that you just think mightn't necessarily be of any merit or help. Don't undervalue anything, because that one person that you couldn't quite be bothered sending the email to, or getting the DVD and giving them the DVD of the, or the tape or whatever it is, they could be the ones that back you. They could be the ones that give you that seed funding. They could be the ones that connect you with the person that leads to that. So in that sense, tell your story. Don't be shy. Don't feel like you're repeating it. Tell your story to people and make it engaging. We need imagination. We need awe and wonder, and have awe about what you do. Don't feel like, oh, you know, this is just my little thing and I don't know. Go out and tell people about it, because that's the only way that your story is going to be told. And then the more people it's in front of, the more chance you have of stepping out of the usual troughs that people get in, because they go, oh, it's not going anywhere. Oh yeah, it's not going to go anywhere. Blah, 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 blah. Ring up. I've had people contact me and, you know, they just go, oh, well, someone said I should just call you. I go, well, if you don't call, I might be able to do anything, but it's the same with anyone else. That person in your town that may be the manufacturer of that thing, run it by them. They could have an idea. Put things in front of people. That would be my best bit of advice.
What is the piece of advice you wish you would have gotten when you started your journey as a change maker?
Probably something along the lines of, it's better to travel well than to arrive. Don't set such a destination in stone that, oh, that's what I'm going to do and that's my duty in this world, because, you know, life is just so open to change, and you're going to meet people that are going to offer other opportunities that will still have a similar destination, but not that fixed, not that fixed latitude and longitude that some people just so dogmatically go for. They go, well, that's what I'm going to do. And then they get these outs where they could have just manipulated or maneuvered around the bend, but they hung on there until they reached a dead end. And it's a real shame, because then all that energy was wasted. They have to back out, or they're just spent and they go off and do something different. So yeah, set destinations, but have a destination board that you can just roll. And if, when someone says, oh, now come over here, go over there, align with this group, that group's, go there, do a little bit with this person, spend some time over there. And that way you are actually being the change, like not just making change. You're actually being changeable, if I can put it that way, rather than just saying, well, my destination is change. It's actually what you do along the way and who you meet and how you can value add and leverage off other groups, but in a supportive way, not like, thank you, I'll just tread, you know, sort of, oh, okay, oh, I help them. And no, not that. Actually work with groups and get, build synergies, and, you know, have your flame and be engaging and maintain your purpose, but also have that flexibility and don't mind ruffling the feathers a bit.
Where are you putting your passion and energy at the moment, and what are your plans for the future?
Into giving people the chance to really just with gay abandon get into growing, but also connecting that to the big picture, that it's not only what I eat and what I put in my body, but it's also what I put on my body. So in my body, on my body, and around my body. And so if people start to play with those concepts and start to take different things out and learn about the toxicity that's around them, then they can actually start to change it. And in changing that, they change the food system, and then they change the world around them, and then that will change the world. So yeah, it's about the food system. And rather than thinking about it as a tricky concept of food system, just think about it as, where do I get my mouthfuls from, and how can I be a part of that process?
All right, Costa, thank you again for this amazing conversation. And for your generosity on sharing the insights of your journey with me.
That's a pleasure.